Okay, got some chats. Okay, till now all are happy. I got a very good suggestion from Ramesh. It's a very good suggestion. So what I do is, I got some waiting room. I just admit, sorry. Admit. Yeah. Okay, so what I do is, let me, an example, I want to give it later, but let me just emphasize on this slide and I'll go further, okay? Okay, as Ramesh was telling, to give more information of the process. So one of the main thing, you know, as you can see here, you can see for COVID, we take as an example, some countries reacted very well. The reason, they had the information, right information, first thing. And second thing is right advisors. Okay, if you think of India, India has got a mortality rate very less. At the same time, they have curtailed the spread of the virus. At the same time, US is the opposite way. Why is the reason? Actually, there was a simulation did by US, by one of the non-profit organization by Bill Gates Foundation. They simulated for a pandemic. You can see here, they got so much of systems isolated in silo systems. The right information was not given. At the same time, right information was not extracted. That is the reason. Okay, moving forward, why enterprise architecture? One of the key things for enterprise architecture is, first of all, EA acts as a strategic tool. It's going to give an option to prioritize the investment and to achieve the business objective. It was, from last 20 years, the role of the EA is the same. Now also it is the same. But only reason it has shifted, in the last 20 years or 10 years, it was CapEx model, you're going to have an infrastructure 5 to 10 years. So EA role was limited only at that initiatives kind of a thing. But moving forward, because in cloud, the product lifecycle or services lifecycle can be few weeks or few months. So an EA role becomes predominant. Okay, then. You must develop the business capability that must be shareable across. There's no way, you know, like the different systems came. See how many people have worked in single sign-on here. Every system had their own single sign-on. So there was a project how to make a single sign-on across the enterprise. So, but now we've got one centralized system giving that authentication authorization for the systems. Then harmonize the business processes, because different departments had different business processes. Try to see what can be reuse, shareable, and how to optimize it. Then interoperability is the biggest thing. I was working in the health. Health, I'm not saying it is, because they have so much of legacy systems, it is taking a while to move towards the modern kind of a integration platform. Still, they're using some kind of a, sometimes it is hard-coded adapters. So moving forward, it must be a REST API, and it must be like everything like a JSON call. That's where you get the flexibility, especially just for the information of, because we're talking about the health industry here. In the health industry, what they do is they got something called an EMR, electronic medical record. So what happens if the electronic medical record must be one single source of truth? So, but unfortunately, in many countries, they got EMR, means the electronic medical record is spread across. Different hospitals got their own thing, is not centralized yet. Yes, it's going towards that path. It may take some more years. Only if you've got a centralized record, then you can able to make the accurate decisions. Okay, then enable availability of information in real time. This is the most important thing. I just give a small case study. SAP is spending a lot of money on health industry. The reason is SAP, one of the CIO was in US. He had an accident. His eyes had a problem. So he was not able to get his record in actual time. So because of that, he lost his eyes. So afterwards, he initiated health, and health has become one of the vertical sector in SAP, because real-time information was not available for him from Germany to US. Then flexible infrastructure is available, but make use of it. Because I told you, because the systems are built for vertical scaling. When you go to cloud, make use of the flexibility. Complexity must be reduced because the systems are monolithic, make it micro. Enhance collaboration, because before the systems were bought based on individual needs, especially moving towards a centralized business process or centralized harmonized process, you need to collaborate with the business. Yes, EA brings in alignment. Just in a few slides, we'll be talking why it brings in. Okay. All are happy till now? Anything? All are happy? Okay, benefits of EA architecture. I'll not go much of this one. Okay, here one of the key things is high alignment between the organization business processes and very important thing, what systems you buy. Okay, I was involved in one of the projects. Still there, it's an account of the company name. They upgrade for JD Edwards. See, company is going to JD Edwards at this time, you know, I feel it's something wrong. The cash reach or somebody is not advising them properly. Then facilitate clear communication between different groups of people. That's what EA brings in. See, EA brings in transparency. Everybody is answerable what decisions they take because everything is in black and white. It gives a clear roadmap. First of all, the business process and day-to-day operations. Please get into the mind. When you work as a project manager, a project is a temporary endeavor. You got a start date and an end date. The project is done, you walk out of the project. But as an EA practitioner, it's forever. EA is there as a dormant in some companies where the maturity is not there. If the maturity is there, an EA is very prominent. Okay. Then effective management of the IT systems. See, many times, you know, like there's no effective usage of your ROI on the systems what we invest. But with EA, it's possible having a proper KPIs. Governance is a very important thing. That's where the decision making comes into play. Let us look what is the drivers. Okay. Let us open up the session now. How many of you know what is digital transformation? Are you working digital transformation? Guys, please, I'm in the chat. You can send me a message. I'm not receiving any message. Okay, I'm not getting anything. Okay, let me explain. See, digital transformation, the moment a company bought its first telephone, or the moment they bought any kind of a system, even a printer, or even any kind of a data entry system, they're digital. So as the technology evolved, they started picking up the technology to suit the business, to make it more agile, or to reduce the cost, or to reduce the human resources, what is needed. So every company is using technology to innovate the business. Unfortunately, 20 years back, only top companies were able to use the what you were going to use, like the CRM or all the latest technology, what we're using, but was not possible to use by mid-range companies because it was very expensive. Now technology is a commodity. Once it's a commodity, and especially with the 4G and 5G coming so near, a mobile phone becoming less than $100, think of the evolution is going to occur. So digital transformation is nothing but the moment you started using technology, you're digital compliant. Yes, the next thing, because of COVID, what's happening? Because of COVID, the workforce is working from the home. See, before, if you go to any company, they're a customer centric. The customer centric is how to make a self-service for the customer. But now the companies realize because of COVID, it's not only self-centered for the customer. How can we able to make a self-service for our staff who support the customer also? Just for an example, when this COVID occurred, in Westpac has got about some 3,000 people working in India for the outsourcing companies. So suddenly India, their option was to go to the home. So what happened is they had sensitive data. So they put a VDX, VDI, the virtual desktops, and the thin clients were shipped to the houses of the support people in India. So taking this as an example, what I mean to say is that's where your compliance, security, the market force is COVID, security, compliance, everything comes into play. So with the EA, it is possible to manage in a well-organized way. Okay, so technology stack, we got so many, cloud, mobile, social, IoT. Of course, I just stopped here. I'm not putting this quantum computing. See, still many more are there, okay? Okay. Because I'm talking about health, let me just talk a little bit about zoonotic disease. Because the reason why, you know, according to the research what I made and according to the market what I'm listening, zoonotic disease is existing from last centuries. It's nothing but a pathogen passing from animal to human. At the same time, it will be forever. The reason, because the drivers, climate change is occurring. We saw the burning of the bushfire and flooding last year. Urbanization is happening in a rapid way. Mass displacement and deadly engineered pathogen. You know, there's some investigation happening. Nobody knows. So the message, what I want to say is, the future systems we're going to design is, it is going to be like, we're going to coexist with a zoonotic disease or like a coronavirus. So you may, like yesterday, there's an article in the newspaper stating that by the time we get the immunity, it may take 4 to 5 years. So this will be an ongoing cycle. So the systems we're going to design is not only for digital transformation, where the customer can able to, customer can be supported by the staff sitting anywhere in the world. That's the concept. Okay, let me now come to the meat of the today's class. See, I give you the complete concept. See, today you can see my narration. I'm trying to abstract TOGAF from enterprise architecture. TOGAF is one of the enterprise architecture framework. This is how your concept must come to you also. When you design a system, the technology capability must be abstracted from the actual implementation of the product. Then it's only, you'll be a good architect or able to give the business the flexible systems what they want to see. Okay, next. First of all, understand what is a framework. How many of you know what is a framework here? Have you come across any framework? Can you just mention a name, please, on the chat? Okay, I did not see any message. Any framework you come across, guys? COBIT framework, yes. I got from ETOM, ITIL, COBIT, governance, fine, fine, very good. Yes, great. You're talking, guys. I'm very happy for this. Yes. Hey, what a framework does is, it gives you like what kind of activities need to be performed at what stage. A very good example is ITIL. ITIL is a very good framework. It exactly tells what, how the service need to be managed, where need to be strategized, how to need the change management. If you take PMI, it's the same thing. PMI is a very good framework. So what is an architectural framework? An architectural framework, what it does is, it exactly tells what are the methods. Sorry, guys, just 1 minute. Okay, stop. Okay, record. Just check the recording is there. Okay, so what a framework does is, especially in terms of an architecture, it exactly tells what the way you must design a target architecture or target state, what's supposed to be. See, the role of an enterprise architect is to future-proof. If you want to future-proof, the important thing is your target state, how it must look. It's not the question of how much cost you're saving, how much flexibility you're giving to the business to change the architecture on the need basis. Then you must determine the building blocks. Building blocks means like what kind of artifacts, the solutions you want to deliver, and what kind of tools are required. And one important thing from COVID you're seeing, we need a common vocabulary, okay? Then what standards need to be there? So one of the main thing, you know, how many of you have heard about a Salesforce was implemented by Bank of Queensland and it was called off? Does anyone know about this story? Okay, I'll tell you why it is so important for the standards. Commonwealth Bank of Queensland in Sydney, they implemented Salesforce. They spent $18.5 million. Then they went to Salesforce because Australia has got a law, the standards, compliance of this one. They call it sovereignty law. Sovereignty law means the data of the customer must not leave the country. So when they went to Salesforce wrote, sorry, we cannot give away our data center. It's our trade secret. Then what happened is, then unless you give the location, we cannot able to change our, we cannot able to implement. They told, no, sorry. Then $18.5 million went for a trash because they did not know the compliance. So they did not have an enterprise architect. You got the point? So this is where a framework gives you future thinking, what need to be done. Okay, next. Let us see, what is TOGAF then? TOGAF is a standard, it's a framework plus a methodology for the enterprise architecture by itself. Then it provides you the tool, methods. See, I told you a framework will give you exactly what need to be done. It just gives you a path, do A, B, C, D. But a methodology will tell you exactly at each and every point, what is the input you expect? What is the output you expect? At the same time, it gives you documentation or the template it provides you. So TOGAF is both a methodology and a framework, okay? It assists the acceptance, production, and maintenance. See, I told you, you know, if you're a project manager work is to just deliver and give to the operations and walk off. But as an enterprise architect, your role is to ensure whatever you implemented gives benefit to the business. So the maintenance also comes under the umbrella of enterprise architect. So now you're getting the what is the role of an enterprise architect. At the same time, is it possible to do at one time? No, it's not possible. So it must be an iterative process. You must follow the best practices. And the main objective of an architect is to produce reusable assets. Don't reinvent the wheel. Okay? That is TOGAF. Then, it considers, it's a standard for the enterprise architecture. In this sense, it gives you a book of knowledge. See, TOGAF is about 547 pages. It's not possible to mug up end to end because it is changing, not so rapidly as technology because it's a specification. But still, there are some changes coming. It's a book of reference. So what is my role in the next few classes is, I'll tell you how to refer the document. When you want to get the right information, how to refer it. Where to find it at least. It's free. It's available in the online. Okay, first of all, why TOGAF is free? TOGAF has come from Department of Defense. So Department of Defense had a framework called the Technical Architecture Framework for Information Management Systems. So they gave it free for the open group in 1995. If the same TOGAF was done by IBM or Microsoft, they would charge you millions of dollars. You have a framework called IAF from Capgemini that was implemented in Westpac. They spent a few millions, but unfortunately, it was not well implemented. So now they went for TOGAF. Okay. And the next thing, because it is from the open group, it's a consortium. The decisions are taken based on consensus. It is completely free and is one of the best framework which you get for free and you can use it for free. At the same time, TOGAF is a descriptive framework. It's not a prescriptive. Plus, it has got a lot of phases which is not applicable for every company. So depending on the company's process, methodology, org structure, you're going to tailor TOGAF on your need basis. And one thing, you can see this picture here. What TOGAF says is an enterprise can be a system of systems. So TOGAF gives the thought process of an enterprise a system. So for a system, you bring in one more system, it must cohesively must work together. It must not be like two different entities. That's one thing. And next important thing, what TOGAF says is an enterprise defines what kind of systems it needs based on the stakeholders. The stakeholders can be department, it can be individuals. So based on that, you select an architecture which is defined by the product. Moving forward, with EA as a practice, the products must not be dictated. It must be come from the architecture perspective. It must be a top-down approach. See, many companies, they are saying, you know, if you go to, especially in first-class airline, in the airlines, so what they do is, especially in the first-class launch, they put all these SAP, IBM kind of brochures. Because they say an executive will go in a first class, comes back a business class. They say, come on, we go for some kind of a system. So that's all product defined by, we call as bottom-up approach. But an enterprise architect, it must come from top-down approach. Okay, so what is the core architecture of TOGAF? So I told you TOGAF is vendor-neutral, product-neutral kind of an architecture we're going to produce. So on that basis, what are the core architecture in TOGAF? Has anyone come across? Typically in enterprise, what kind of architecture you come across? Can someone type me a message, please? Question for the audience. Yeah, I got one answer, BDAT. Ram, I think you have gone to some course. Because BDAT word will not come in. It's good. You came across good. Anyone else, please? Anyone else? I was expecting data architecture. You got one of our partners here. Okay, no problem. Any business, what comes into your mind? The moment SOA is good, Mike came with business SOA. Yes, all are architectures. I'll come across everything. Okay, the moment you think of any business, any kind of an environment, it can be government, it can be commercial enterprise, it must be having some kind of business architecture. The business architecture is defined by the type of the enterprise, the organizational structure, the key stakeholders. So they'll define the strategy. They'll define what kind of business process they need, functions they need, governance they need. So irrespective of any domain, there is a business architecture that must get into your mind today. Then every business need to be implemented to realize it. That is done by an application architecture. So the application architecture gives the blueprint, how the individual applications need to interact with each other, how it's going to fit in an enterprise. Then, so the message here is the application architecture must be able to realize the business architecture. It's not the other way around, but unfortunately, it's the other way around. How many of you come across SAP? They bring a SAP system and they don't use the whatever the standard structure there. They build a mini SAP within the organization. Have you come across the stories, guys? Okay, then to realize the application architecture, then you come with the technology architecture. Please remember the technology architecture, if a company, example, if it is very technology innovative, so the technology stack they're going to choose might be from open source. So the technology stack, first they're going to define what capability they want. Then they choose a technology stack depending on the risk appetite, depending on the compliance, what they got, and finally depending on the budget and depending on some criteria I cannot disclose in the public. So based on that one, the technology architecture need to exactly tell what kind of capability and how it can be realized from the application perspective. Ultimately, it must realize the business objective. What is missing here? Can anyone think what is missing here? Yes, data. Good. Who is this? Data is missing. Why data is missing? Rupin. Okay, Rupin is saying data is missing. The reason is, when Ram told about that, see, in TOGAF, still now, TOGAF has got, we call it the core architecture or the core domain. We call it business architecture, information system architecture, and technology architecture. In the ADM cycle, will be coming across in a short while. So what it's TOGAF was, when it was done in 1995, information technology, its application was wrapped with the data together. Data was not a separate entity. In 2013, they came with Archimate. In the Archimate, it was separated. So data cuts across from the business perspective, application perspective, as well as technology perspective. So data is everywhere. Okay. So on that aspect, we take data as a separate entity. Then TOGAF has not included this, especially with the global village, what we're facing now. Our architecture, our data is to be considered our partners too. See, many times you generate a report, you take the data from the partners. Okay. So this is the core architecture of TOGAF, the core domain. If someone want to take an exam, next week I start introducing the question papers. Okay. How the question papers will look. One or two questions I start putting in. Okay. So what happens here is just these four concepts you get 3 marks. Okay. So seeing this, what you must get into your mind now, irrespective of the domain, irrespective of the type of the business or type of the organization or size of the organization, this BDAT, what we call business data application technology, is technology neutral, vendor neutral, and every company needs this. That's why I told you, as an enterprise architect, you go in, this is what the work you'll be doing. You can able to get the information, no need of having any previous experience of any other domain, I want to say. But of course, you must interact with the customers to get that concept. So till all are okay till now? Any doubts? Because now I'm jumping into the core concepts. I keep for a while looking at any kind of questions I'm getting here. If I don't get, I'll jump in. All good? Great? Okay. Now, the core concepts. How many of you seen this? Okay. Yes, few people have seen this. That's great. Frequently, that's David. Good. Okay, Ram. Great. Okay. Now, let's see. First of all, when you see this, what comes into your mind? You're looking at the arrows going across. If you get this concept, you got 3 marks. Okay. The last slide, you got 3 marks. This slide, you're going to get 3 marks if you get the concept. Nowhere has been explained the concept what I'm explaining, because I got a PhD based on this. Okay, so you can see this P phase, you know, P to A phase, you got double red arrow. This one we call as a phase. Okay, then you have one third arrow for each other phases. Okay, centrally you got requirements management. It has got double red arrow. This is the reason business loves enterprise architects. Because the reason is, anytime you have a say to make the changes, of course, it depends your influence, your how well you document, how well you're able to convince the people. But this framework gives a flexibility to change the business needs whenever we want. So this is the brain or core of enterprise architecture, or the heart, depending on what you call it. So it's a, what it gives is a tested, repeatable process. Actually, Open Group came with 9.2 version last year. So what they did is, they went across globally to say, do we need to change the ADM cycle? So after, this ADM cycle is there from 1995. It has never changed. So then the whole mass came, no, we want to retain it. So they tested a repeatable process to develop an architecture. I'll explain in much more detail why it is, okay? Then, what it does is, as I told you earlier, TOGAF is a methodology as well as a framework. In the framework, what it says is, vision, set up a vision, do the business architecture, do the information architecture. The information architecture consists of application and data. It gives you a cycle. Did you checkpoint, like a framework. The beauty of TOGAF is it has given you templates. It exactly tells you in A phase, what is the input and what you need to do there and what is the output. So it gives it a input document. What is expected? It gives you the steps, what need to be followed. Then exactly it tells what are the deliverables from A phase. So TOGAF is a methodology. Then, again, TOGAF is a iterative process. See, if I want to set up an enterprise architecture for the Ministry of Health, which I did in Mongolia. So what we did is, first of all, we took a high level process. Okay, at that time, what they wanted, the project, what I worked for them is, they wanted to have, because Mongolia had a problem, they had 85% of the drugs were counterfeit. So they wanted, right from the license issuing authority to import the drugs, all the way to the doctor giving the prescription and a dispensary dispensing the drugs must be tracked in real time. That is the one we gave a proposal for them. I completely worked on that model. So if you think in that aspect, what comes into your mind? So first of all, you come with a high level, then you go deeper and deeper as you get more information comes through. Something like a Prince 2 concept or like an Agile concept. First you go with a high level, then you go in much more detail. So said that, TOGAF is an iterative process and an incremental delivery. I'll come to it a little bit later. Then TOGAF is a method. So what it does is, for every company, you know, it's not possible, it's a heavy framework. It's not a lightweight framework. Some companies have the concept of only outsourcing. For them, they need to have only some of the concepts they may use. They may use basically from B phase and basically from E and F phase they may use. Some companies outsource the data perspective. They don't even look at it. So depending on type of the organization, so ADM can be customized and tailored. Okay? All okay till now? Okay, I want to give a next one concept, then I'll come back to this one, okay? So TOGAF is a iterative and incremental process. Why is the reason? So what is iterative? How many of you work in iterative process? See, what is the main difference between waterfall and iterative? See, waterfall, what we do is, we just go A, once A is done, B, B is done, C. It was the process happening, especially in the CapEx kind of an expenditure of a model. I was working as a developer. My project manager was saying, hey, did you get freeze the requirement? Did you get the sign off from the customer? That was what I was getting. But moving forward in the iterative process, what we do is we want the big picture. This is the one we want to achieve. We want to, in the iterative process, we go step by step. Customer, are you happy with it? Yeah, then we go to the next step, next step. What was happening in the last 10 years? We call it the Big Bang theory. You go to a customer, take the requirements, because software is intangible, the customer not able to understand. At the end result, instead of seeing Manav Lisa, you'll be seeing someone else. Then incremental approach. See, CapEx model, this is the way we go. But especially with OpEx model, with service architecture, everything is a service. What we go to the customer is, hey, customer, this is what you want? Yes. We give them incremental delivery. See, incremental delivery is something like your agile. Every time you got a working software. So together, all these years, it was not utilized in the company because the reason was, you go as a TOGAF consultant, you tell, okay, go for a SAP, this is the KPI, this is the ROI, everything you're going to give. Unfortunately, by the time the system is implemented, by the time the business realizes the service, it's been outdated, the business model has changed. There's no way to track back the KPIs. So especially now, moving forward in the cloud era, or might be in the OPEX era, what we call is go for the low-hanging fruit and give them incremental delivery where the business can able to utilize it. Okay. So now TOGAF is, what do you think? How is TOGAF iterative and incremental? Can anyone type me a message? Why do you think? TOGAF always follows incremental model. Manoj is telling. Yes, good. Then anyone else? Mike is telling it is both. Yes, now I'll give a proper concept for you back. See, TOGAF is, as you can see here, let me explain this concept. By the end of this concept, you'll get the complete understanding of what I'm talking. See, TOGAF, we got a P phase. Only P phase, you got double-edged arrow here. The reason why, you know, P phase is used when you want to start set up a new architecture, practice in an enterprise, first. Next, when an enterprise wants to go, becomes a reorg, might be it gets merged, or might be it is reduces some of the business units, they sell it off. Then P phase is revisited. So P, or sometimes there's a major change in the environment, might be some strategy or might be some kind of a technology change, or COVID is one of the good driver. So then P phase is revisited. Then, in the A phase, we define the scope. Please, guys, one thing must go into your mind. Just because enterprise architecture is there means there's no use of a project manager. Enterprise architecture works together or collaborates with the PMO office. So when you come and define in the A phase, you identify as a project. You're going to define what are the KPIs, what is the outcome, what is the ROI? Everything is going to come in a very high level. In project management perspective, we call it rough order of magnitude. Means it can be 50-50% plus or minus, because still we don't have the detailed information. Then we're going to do the core architecture, I told you. That is the BCD. So BCD means business information system consists of application and data and technology. Okay. See, the technology, when I mean to say technology, please, you must get this into your mind. I say cloud. Cloud means we are not talking about AWS. We say data base. We're not talking about SQL. We're not talking about MySQL or MS SQL. So everything is based on the capability of what we need. So as you can see here, from A, B, C, D, it goes in a waterfall methodology. At the same time, what all the documents you produce, see, again, one thing you must get into the mind, TOGAF is verbose, means it generates enormous amount of documentation. Okay, TOGAF does not give you an end-to-end of what is like a modeling. I'll be talking about that one a little bit later in the next class. TOGAF will not build an architecture, but it enhances, it gives the concept how to make a better architecture. So said that. So when you're coming into B, the requirements goes back into requirements management. As you can see here, the output of B goes back in requirements management. When you come into C, partially you take from C, historical data, you can't look back into requirements management. If something need to be done, you go revisit back to B or revisit back to A also. For an example, if a company were using 4G example, so 5G becomes a reality. So they don't want to just implement a project which will become redundant in the next few months. So they go and revisit. Okay, then. So this is a core architecture. We define, analyze the architecture. Okay, then once we define the architecture, analyze the architecture, next what we are going to do is, based on what kind of solution, the architecture building blocks we call. So whatever the building blocks we produce, building blocks is nothing but, it can be a document, it can be a specification, it can be some kind of KPIs expecting, all we call as building blocks. The building blocks varies depending on business architecture. The building blocks will be in perspective of business architecture perspective, in application data perspective, application and data, technology perspective. So here we call is the capabilities, what is expected. Only when you come to E, then we see what solution we need. The solution can be in terms of a product. What products are available? Do we want to go for on-prem? Or do we want to go for a cloud? Or do we want to go for example like SAP or some kind of a ERP? So based on here, you're going to analyze what are the products available. Based on the products, you'll go back to the business and get the opinion and get the approval. Then you come with the F phase. That's where the planning is done. Depending on what is approved, on what budget the company is having, what kind of risk appetite they're having, and what is the business initiative. So once that is done, in the implementation phase is the one, the actual product gets implemented. Not only gets implemented, the governance phase verifies and validates whatever has been agreed in the A phase has been implemented. At the same time, you get the outcome. Then we have the H phase. H phase is a very interesting thing because the reason is H phase is nothing but is a board. This consists from the business, from the architecture, from project management. So what they do is, they don't sit and look for what's happening. They're not on reactive mode. They'll be proactive mode. Proactive mode means they look at the competitors. They look at the upcoming technology. They see how they can able to innovate, how they can able to be ahead of the competitors. That's where the H phase comes into play. At the same time, as once you're running your ADM phase, there might be some kind of catastrophic failure, what happened in COVID. So many companies, especially the outsourcing companies, will be very happy because they're able to get the resources on board quickly now. And they can get support the businesses across the world sitting in wherever they want. At the same time, because of this, a lot of things need to be revisited, your security, your policies, everything. So what happened is the whole outsourcing model will be redefined. So whatever a company is having the outsourcing model will be revisited. That's where the H phase comes into play to see proactively what can be done. Okay. Then you have the R phase. This is the most important thing. In the R phase is the one which always ensures. See, sometimes, you know, we get some kind of a new initiative or some kind of a requirement or some kind of a wish list. Whatever the wish list comes, as a pigeonhole, it goes to requirements management and everything will be tied up. At the same time, whichever phase you're doing, always refer back to the documentation here to see anything is related. You may ask me a question. Is it possible to see all this with so much of documentation generated? Yes, it is not possible. It was not possible before, but now it is possible because all what we are seeing here, everything can be modeled and the model can be related and everything can be connected. I'll be coming and discussing about in the coming classes. Okay. So TOGAF is an incremental, is an iterative process. At any time, you can revisit any phase you want. Then it's an incremental delivery. Incremental delivery means in the B phase, I may come out with a complete business architecture document, get an approval. Same time, I may, based on some of the objectives, I may start implementing, giving the result to the business. At the same time, any business wants any changes, I can go back, revisit. So you'll be having multiple sprints. If you're talking from the perspective for Agile, you'll be having multiple sprints. For a hospital now, suppose COVID came in, what happened? What things comes to first into your mind? you can see, you know, many countries, they told, okay, now we go for telehealth. Telehealth was not an option all these days. But now, even in Australia, the government permitted, because of it's a risk of going to the hospital. You got small ailment, you can have your Zoom, can talk to your doctor, get a prescription. You're okay with it. So many countries are doing this one. So I mean to say, things can be flexible to make the required to change to meet the environment conditions. So all are okay till now? Anything, please send me a message. So you got the core concept. The core concept is, if you want to build a hospital, a Ministry of Health, they want to have a centralized system where they can able to get real-time information of the patients, because health records are maintained, we call it the EMR, electronic medical record. And each state, they got their own EMR systems. Each hospital, they got their own EMR systems. How to have a centralized system? See, the country I'm talking is a fictitious country. I'm not referring to any country. So I'm telling you actually what's happening in the industry. And every private hospital, they got their own EMR systems. So how to have a consolidated record? How to have the exact information of the patient in real time? So for that one, they want to build a system. To build a system, what we need to build this kind of a capability is a collaboration of people, the process you follow, the technology you're going to use. So based on that, what we need to do? So we're going to take a practice of EA. When we do EA, what is the important thing comes into your mind? See, typically if you take an enterprise, an enterprise, you'll be having a project. A project is nothing but it comes into place to build a product. So for the lifetime of a product or life cycle of a product, there are n number of projects comes into play. At the same time, for an enterprise, n number of products will come into play. For a Ministry of Health is an organization. It exists as long as the country exists. So as long as the country exists, you have a Ministry of Health. As long as Ministry of Health exists, they need to have an enterprise architecture practice. Sometimes it can be dormant, sometimes it can be active. So once it's active, means it's going to take a top-down approach based on the strategy. It exactly looks, hey, what needs to be done? How to future-proof? How to get the flexibility for the organization to have a real kind of a system? How to avoid duplicate kind of a systems? So for that, you need a proper framework. That's where TOGAF comes into play. Okay, now we say, what is next? Okay, I got something here. Rupen is telling, architecture change management is not that a constant iterative process, or it is an incremental. Okay, guys, I got a question from Rupen here. So what he's telling is, the architecture change management is not that a constant iterative process, or it's incremental. See, it depends. See, governance is always there, the change management. Governance is the one which does the change management. Of course, it advises to the change management board what can be done, because the change management board does not come into place every time. It might be once in a month, depending on the type of the organization, or once in 2 weeks, they'll be having that call. In between, any kind of a governance is done by the governance board by itself. It constitutes based on the project managers, enterprise architects. So depending on your what kind of options you're having, or what kind of limitations. So change management is not completely active. Only when you exceed certain threshold, then only it comes into place to call a meeting and to get, like a parliament coming in together to take a decision. Otherwise, if there's no major issues, it comes once in a month, they take a decision. Okay, then did I answer your question, Rupen? Okay, thank you. Then afterwards, I got one more question here. TRM or open text can be used as a central DMS to maintain all the artifacts of PA. See, Mike is telling like an open text can be used for the central repository. Mike, it can be used, but I'll be talking in the next class. We have got something called Archimate. Archimate is a modeling language which connects end to end. For the kind information, you bought me this one. At the end of the session, I'll show you. I'm giving a talk on this for the open group. At the end of the session, I'll explain you why modeling is a very important thing for an enterprise. I can show you the slide after the class. So you guys got a time, please attend that. I'll give you the URL after it's finished. Okay, then any other question I'm seeing here? TOGAF, okay, TRM, fine, Archimate. Okay, Mike is telling RE's tool. Okay, just for the information, I'll be coming across what are the tools available for enterprise architecture. One of the key thing is you have a EA tool. You'll be surprised, guys. A good EA tool like RE, like Mega and all, just about 3-4 years back, it was costing you like $500,000 to implement. And now we have our own EA tool, which is Sparks built in Melbourne. It costs you less than $1,000. But again, you know, what you pay, what you get. So ultimately, you must be having a tool which is very intuitive and able to, with less learning curve. So how to produce, I'll be talking about that in the coming classes. So again, you've got a lot of open source tool. I'll be taking a separate session, might be like 10-15 minutes I'll be covering in the coming class. Okay, then moving to the next one. Okay, now let us see what is the drivers of the Ministry of Health. I just put something. See, now we know, I discussed about, because it's more of like a what we call as the interactive class, because you must get that concept in your mind. So I told the case study, the Ministry of Health, they want to go for example, they want to utilize technology as an aspect because they got legacy system, they want to give better service, and COVID made a big impact on them. No way they can able to have the traditional way they're operating. They need to have a real-time information of the data of the customer information, the patient information. As an architect, what are the drivers? I just came, cut the cost 30% they want to bring in. They reduce the staff. So one of the main thing, you know, India was very aggressive into bringing the, what I can say is lockdown. The reason is India has got, for 10,000 people, it has got 3.2 doctors. Australia has got 3.2 doctors for 1,000 people. So especially moving forward, as I told you, this pandemic can be a regular event, or coronavirus coexists with us. It's like a flu. Every few months it comes, you must develop the resistance till you truly get to some kind of a vaccination. So based on that, they want to cut the cost plus increase the service. Okay, what they need to do. So what are the drivers? You tell me. It must be interactive, guys. What are the other drivers you're thinking? Okay, I got one more here, like request, who is responsible for build? Okay, just little bit of out of the question. I can just tell one question I got from Rao. Rao is telling, sometime back in Zachman framework was quite popular for architecture. Is it still being used? The various architecture available in the market, Zachman was a one-man army, John Zachman. It was not been like... But Open Group is a consortium. Now they got more than 600 companies like HP, IBM, and top companies, manufacturing, Intel. So it's a consortium of everyone. So it's a standard which sees how we can able to have boundless information flow. So boundless information flow means information must be accessed anytime, that kind of systems we need to build. So they take the input from across and they're building this framework. So Zachman is there, but Zachman is not so comprehensive as this one. What is that? TOGAF. Then I got one more question from Shaumik. So Shaumik is asking is like, as usual, my question is around requirements management. Who is responsible for building the requirements management at the enterprise level? Guys, a very good question. The question is, who does the requirements management? The requirements management is done by everyone, but it is driven by the enterprise architect. At the same time, in the one of the slides I'll be showing you in the coming this one, it is built on the in the consultation with the key stakeholders. But as the implementation comes across, you go with all the levels depending on the type of the project and the scope of the project. It's a very good question. I'll be explaining much more detail as later. Okay, next, coming back, I got one more question from Rao. BA usually does the requirements management as usual. Yes, BA does the requirements management. But BA must work under the umbrella of enterprise architect to get the requirements management. I'll just show you in the next one or two slides. Okay, next, coming back here, telehealth. So one of the main thing is drivers is telehealth. So we want to reduce the cost. And you can, because nowadays you got that kind of a systems or that kind of what I can say is devices to monitor your heartbeat, to see your blood flow, to your oxygen content in your this one, what is that, blood. your BP can be measured remotely. And I came across one of the things, like in India, a doctor was sitting in a remote place, can able to do the surgery. So robots are coming into play. So all is there. So components, now let me explain the components, what is required, different kind of components, how TOGAF works together. TOGAF does not work in isolation. See, today what I covered is, I just told you what are the key concepts. I explained what is TOGAF. So I explained to you what is the ADM. So how an ADM is a step-by-step approach. It is incremental as well as it's an iterative process. That's what I explained to you. Again, at the same time, some of the key concepts, as I go across, I'll be explaining you much more detail. Because one day if I tell you all the things, I may not see you in the next class. Just joking. There are a lot of things need to be remembered. Again, it's a vocabulary, you know. Once you come to your place, when I came from Singapore to Australia, some of the words was difficult for me to pick up. So once I get the local words, it was easy to mingle around. Same thing, when you come across the new architecture framework, you are using in a day-to-day life. Might be there some keywords need to recall, that's all. I'll be explaining as I go across. See, to use the ADM cycle, TOGAF has given some kind of guidelines and techniques. I'll be explaining. At the same time, TOGAF is not limiting. Please follow only these techniques and guidelines. It is just as an advisory. Use this one if you want. It suits you. Otherwise, no need to use. Again, one good thing is all these techniques and guidelines, TOGAF is not reinventing the wheel. They're picking the best practice across the world and they're made as part of the documentation or specification. I'll be explaining this in the coming classes. Okay. Next, as I told you earlier, TOGAF generates enormous amount of documentation. So the documents must be having some kind of a structure. So the Architecture Content Framework describes what is the type of meta model, or what kind of reusable artifacts, how to define that. So it gives you that kind of a structure. Just for the information, some of you are from data space, I know here, or some of you are not from the data space. A model is nothing but it's a structure. You have like a Excel sheet, you have a column, you have the rows, it exactly tells. So the row and column, it can be a alphabet, or it can be a numerical, or it can be alphanumerical. So if you got like 3-4 Excel sheets combined together, we call it a meta model. Irrespective of the Excel sheet, wherever you put the data, it must follow some structure. Similarly, TOGAF has got, because different phases has got different data structure, so they define meta model is model of models. Then, as I told you, TOGAF has given you the structure how the artifacts need to be there. Again, that need to be persisted someplace. So for that one, we call as a continuum. Continuum means it ever grows. So we got enterprise continuum. Again, enterprise continuum exactly tells what kind of taxonomies, because for you to describe, to put in your data. At the same time, see, if you have an Excel sheet, it's good to use. But if you want to use an Excel sheet for a government agency like Australia to look at the health record of a patient, it's not possible. You need to have a multi-dimensional system to manage that kind of a huge record. So similarly, you have a tool to manage the enterprise continuum, the documents generated in a enterprise. So this I'll be discussing might be in the coming classes. Next, what is seeing all this? What is the important capability you need? Skill. See, one of the key thing is, if you want to implement an enterprise architecture practice in an enterprise. So what TOGAF has given is, it has given a framework. That's called the Architecture Capability Framework. It exact discusses. Because the same kind of org structure, you cannot implement EA practice. So it tells what kind of org is required for a EA practice, what kind of process we need to follow, what kind of skills and roles is needed, and what kind of responsibilities. So as I told you earlier, if an enterprise architect is a ceremonial, no way can able to make a EA successful. That's why I told you, 85% of the digital transformation project is a failure. And for your information, it is $3 trillion. You think of the amount of wastage we are incurring because of it. So think of just, all of you coming to this class, I promise you, you get the concept. At least even if you're able to save 0.1%, think of how much savings you'll be doing for the environment. Your life is done, goes in a different path. So said that, what I want to say is, the capability framework exactly tells, of course, we cannot take one-to-one. We can able to customize depending on the type of the company and able to tailor it what is needed for us. So TOGAF components consist of the key concepts what I discussed. ADM, I just came in a high level. I'll be going much deeper in the coming classes. To use the ADM, you got some kind of a guidelines and techniques. Then TOGAF is nothing but generates enormous amount of documentation. So documentation is given a proper structure, how need to be done, like a templates, and that need to be persist in some place. For that, it has got a concept of enterprise continuum. I'll be talking in the next class, coming class. And to achieve all this, we need some kind of a capability. So suppose a Ministry of Health, if they want to adapt the modern technology, so if they want to set up an EA practice, what they're going to do? First of all, we call as nothing but like building the capability. The building the capability means you're going to see what kind of skills they need to have. So what kind of, first of all, we call it capacity building. Capacity building means they may send some of the staff for the EA training. And once they get the EA training or once they get the concepts, then they may get into a consulting company. The consulting company may come in, work together to understand. Because first of all, they must understand the process of what is EA. So once they understand, then they understand what kind of the existing systems they're having. And what kind of how to operate the ADM, what kind of techniques suits them. So all this comes under play. We'll be discussing as we go across. So next, let us look at what are the current issues. The current issues in the health industry is the cost of the doctors. It's very expensive, right? At the same time, shortage of doctors. So how to address this? So in the coming classes, we try to understand from TOGAF perspective what we can able to do. Then again, as an enterprise architecture, what you must think if you want to solve the problem of the Ministry of Health, you must think from the business perspective, technology perspective. This, I just put some indicators. See, what we're today we're doing is we're just triggering your thought process. As an enterprise architect, we don't go and look at the technology. We look at the business perspective, technology perspective, internal, what is the process they're following, and externally, what are the influence factors we're having. All must come into your mind. Okay. I had one of the questions earlier, right? The requirements we are taking, who is responsible for that? Oh, sorry, guys. I did not update this slide for you today. No problem. See, I told you an enterprise is a system of systems, right? So a system of systems, you're going to have an architecture for that. The architecture you're going to define depends on the stakeholders. And each stakeholder has got their own problem or they want to have some kind of a new capability. So you're going to construct a system, you're going to take the requirement from each stakeholder. Again, say as an enterprise architect, just for giving an understanding for you, the government of Canberra, they came with the minimum pricing model. McKinsey per day for a strategist to put a EA practice across an enterprise, they're charging $16,400 per day. Okay, now the government came with a capping. So any strategy and all anything, please charges only $4,000. 16K is too high. You got the point. So said that, as an enterprise architect, when you're going to look at the stakeholders taking their concern, you cannot take the requirements from everyone. So what you're going to do as an enterprise architect, you're going to look at the key stakeholders. We'll be talking about stakeholders in much more in depth in the coming classes. Who has got the power? Who has got the interest? So based on that, we're going to identify them. Then you're going to take the requirement. And the requirements, what has been taken by an enterprise architect, that will be passed for the business architect or business analyst to take further information to analyze it. Okay. I hope I answered the question. Okay, next, coming back, let me see. One of the questions. Okay, I got a question from Tarak. It's a very good question, guys. The question what he's asking is, what happens when a big merger happens? What is the EA practice approach? Okay. Tarak, is a very good question. As I told you earlier, when a big merger occurs, let us visit this one, or ADM cycle. When a big merger occurs, see, as I told you, the P phase or the preliminary phase, is done occasionally. We're going to revisit because the PFAS exactly tells what kind of methodology you want to use for the enterprise, what kind of skills, what kind of org structure, everything is defined by the PFAS. So this one we revisit occasionally. When you go for a merger, thus then again the P will be revisited and exactly you're going to analyze. So for the new merger, so what kind of process we need to follow? Do we marry, take the existing process, what we're having from our company, or we're going to take from the other company? What is the best for us? I just give an example for this. When Westpac and what is one other bank? I forgot the bank. Westpac merged with another bank. Can anyone recall? So when they merged, what happened is the other bank, they had enterprise data warehouse based on Teradata. So because they had Teradata, the CIO was much more vocal. So Teradata went in a very massive way for Westpac. Yeah, St. George. When St. George merged with Westpac, though St. George was a smaller bank, they were able to influence based on to go for Teradata for Westpac. So I mean to say, when a company gets merger, what happens is it depends on the company's practices. Sometimes you got a best practice, you may pick it for the company. Again, some processes. Suppose, it's a good example. Some companies, when you have example like PMI as a way of doing the project management. And some companies, they got Prince too. So you see what is the advantage, disadvantage. Then you can make a call. Then you can say, okay, henceforth, the whole company will be using only PMI. It can become a set up a standard. Okay. How much time I'm having? Sorry, guys. Okay, still I got 5 minutes time. I'll explain this one. Fine, this is done. Okay, this and all, I'll talk about this later. It's too early at this time. Okay, let me, so because one of the key constraints, you know, when you do any kind of a project, we look at our Ministry of Health. First of all, you must look at what are the functional requirements. So your thoughts process, you know, say, as I told you earlier, enterprise architecture is domain neutral and technology neutral. So on that basis, you think, see, because COVID has become the talk of the day. So you want to see if you want to get a better treatment or if you want to see how the treatment can be given better for citizens, what kind of functional requirement do you expect? Just have a thought process, read up something of it. Then what are non-functional requirements? Then what are the standards need to be followed? See, health sector, you know, they got so much of standards to be followed, right from the procurement to the dispensing of the medicines. Even the treatment they give, everything must be recorded. They need to follow some international standards. So look at that one. Just see, one of the main things, you know, many architects they come across, standards, they say, oh, no, it's not my thing. No, no, because, you know, we don't work in isolation now. So look at the standards, what is required as an EA perspective. Then what are the complaints need to be followed? Then one of the key constraints is time and cost for any kind of a project. See, key takeaways, what we discussed today is, digital transformation happened the moment any company used technology to give better service. With technology becoming a commodity, and especially people working, remote working becomes a norm in the future. So what is happening is we need to adapt technology. It ever evolves and new features comes into play. So that's first thing. And to manage this technology, what is required? We need to have a concept. Becomes a top-down approach. It's nowhere a bottom-down approach. The bottom-down approach means somebody comes with a product and you try to retrofit it back to the strategy or to an enterprise. Does not work in the future. And especially why EA enforces this one is because sometimes somebody can buy some kind of a product. There's no asker, no teller. But enterprise architecture ensures that any decisions are taken in enterprise. There is a consensus, the team of people, and you do a proper kind of a analysis, the report is produced, people signs off, and answerable for that. So enterprise architecture ensures that we'll be discussing in the coming classes. Again, TOGAP is an iterative process and incremental delivery. Because if you give an iterative delivery, you know, what happens is it's not possible. Iterative process to come with the requirement and incremental delivery. It's not olden days, it was one big bang theory means we give a delivery at the end of the project, but not with TOGAP. Next. Okay, I just want to tell what we do. See, one of the main thing is, I tell you from EA perspective what we're doing. Okay? See, basically, our company is born based on the cloud. On that basis, what we do is we look at every company want to go for digital transformation. We first make an assessment. What is the drivers for them? The digital transformation, you know, every company want to become state of the art. At the same time, we must look at what is their budget, their requirement, and their appetite. So then we determine the expectations. Then we come with the maturity assessment. I'll be discussing about maturity assessment deeper in depth the next class. Then we model the capability. Based on the capability, then we identify what kind of methodology suits the company. Then we define the skill sets. Then we assist the product selection. We not go for implementation. That's not our work. Then we got a research arm. That's our MAPS AI, which comes under the umbrella of UTS. So one of the main thing is many companies, you know, they fail in the technology implementation because they don't do research and innovation. They just go and pick some product and come. We constantly research and innovate, and we exactly tell what is needed. That is our strength. In the coming classes, I'll be discussing in the next class, ADM phases in depth. Then I'll be talking about the continuum and tools. And TOGAF has given us two reference models, the TRM, the I3RM. I'll be talking about that one. And the guidelines and techniques, as I cover the ADM phase, I'll be touching the relevant guidelines and techniques for that particular phase. In the last class, we'll be talking about architecture governance. So what is the end result you're going to get out of this class in the next three classes? Next class, I'm going to give you some kind of questions, what you see in a real-time exam. The exam consists of 40 questions. The percentage of pass is only 55%, means you must get right 22 questions. If you're able to come to the next three class, listen to me. I'm trying to bring in a lot of keywords without your notice going into your mind. You can pass the exam. At the same time, at the end of the class, I give you some kind of a material. So the manual, I'm going to give you a manual. If you read that manual and